covers that. Then let's do another activity diagram. The one that I showed you with the actions in them. This one. So we go here and create a new one. It's an activity diagram. And so I start again by picking up my, my activity. I drop it here. This is the assert installation payment milestone. And so again, I blow it up. And I can actually go into the toolbox and find in the toolbox the send and the receive actions. Okay. So I'll take a send and drop it in here. And that gives me here the invoice send action. And I'll do the same thing also with the receive action. For the payment that I'm hoping for. And of course we can put the data. So we have an activity parameter. We choose the customer record again. And now I can go from here, to the invoice. And now a remarkable thing happens. Nothing gets highlighted. Must have been another team that did this. So you can drop it there still and say this is an object flow that is actually dropping an object flow here. And that's, you know, that's how it looks. So we can bend our line at the cursor again, and then it looks a little bit more pleasant. And so this means that the data that is coming through here is dropped there. Now I can pick up this and make a control flow. Again, I can't directly select it here. I click on dependency and then I fix it by setting the, changing the type to control flow. Sure, it's a special form of dependency. Yeah, you're right. But control flow is what you would use to indicate that this kind of dependency exists. So, and then we go to an activity final. Same thing, change type. Okay. And now the only thing left is our timer and the interrupt. So let's put another output parameter, output activity parameter on the border. So this is the one that we'll use. Oops. Well, and when we go to the toolbox to put our timer, we will look and we will look and we will look and we won't find the timer. Okay? If we keep looking, no timer. Okay? It's very, you know, this drove me nuts. Okay? But then I started playing around and I found when I drop an action, you now get asked whether you want to drop an accept time event, okay? And that's what you want to drop. And then the magic happens and you get the timer symbol and you can connect it. And again, we'll have to change the type of the connector. And we change it like earlier to interrupt flow. So now the timer, will produce, at least that's what we're specifying, an event, an interrupt event, when 2 weeks have passed. It auto, yeah, so it's not specified explicitly, but the meaning is that when you have it like this, it starts when this activity starts. Okay. The moment this activity starts, which we can indicate also, if you want to be explicit about this, by an initial. So this particular activity starts when the customer record arrives here and we are at this point, then the 2 weeks start. And if the payment arrives, the timer gets canceled and everything, you know, is like you would want it to be. But if they are not connected to anything else, it starts when that activity starts. So what Chaucer suggested earlier in our conversation is to actually add here a fork point, have this go here, have the fork point go here, and here, okay? So this was the idea, oops, just make this tiny bit more pleasing. So, oh, it's not actually, let me change this. I'm not pleased by this at all. Okay, so anyway, this says now, once the invoice is sent, two things will happen. The timer will be started and we're starting to wait for the payment. Okay, so this was what Chaucer had suggested, which I have tried to implement graphically here. Otherwise, the time would start ticking right when the activity starts. Okay, very good. Let me see. I have created for you in the project browser for your own enjoyment already two activity diagrams. One is called Customer Journey. And that has the customer acquisition, planning and permitting, basically all of these elements that you've seen that we've already used, just so you see how this would look. And I've created another one. Let me see. It's called order execution. Oh, we created this earlier. What else did I create? Was it the inspections? Yes. Ah, this is why I wanted to go there. Yes, because I added some swim lanes here. Okay. And so this is exactly what you saw earlier. Here we have the merge point. Here is the decision point. And I've created two swim lanes in the activity, inside of the activity itself. These swim lanes are just the boxes that you can draw from the toolbox. So you can see it's called actually, where is it? Where did it go? Partition, okay? So they are now referred to as, sorry, you can't see this from the back. They're referred to as partitions, and you can drag them into the diagram just like any other drawing element. And then you will find that these elements, you can see as I'm moving them around, they become attached to the partition, body, the body of the partition, okay? And you can change the direction of them to be vertical or horizontal. Yes, and if you were to model regions, these expansion regions, you can drag a region. And then it will ask you in this particular case whether you want to have an expansion region. And it could be iterative, it could be parallel, or it could stream. Just like I mentioned earlier. So let's pick a parallel one. Again, this is not one, not something that I will elaborate on. I'll just show it to you what it looks like. Okay, so this is what the region looks like. And then you can right click on it again, and then you have new child element. Here would be an expansion node. And here it is. Okay, so then it gets attached, just like if we had picked an activity. I think that's where I'll stop for now. I think you've seen all the major elements and tricks that you need to be successful with these activity diagrams. They're just another form of a behavioral diagram. And I'll show you two other diagram types. I have to stop the broadcast here. One is the component diagram, and the UML is relatively specific what it wants components to be. And it used to be even more specific in the past. when it tried to make components literally binaries, okay, binary components like libraries or executable files. Okay, those were labeled as components. In the meantime, the interpretation has become a little bit more liberal. You can also, you think of components as deployable artifacts, basically. And in particular, also services that have some sort of interface, like an API, an application programming interface. And what I've done here is I've used components to indicate in this diagram. So this would be a component, an example for a component. And with the arrows, you indicate dependencies. Dependencies in the context of components are typically calls that are being made. So one component uses the interface that another component provides. And so you sometimes also see notation like this, where one component says, I'm offering an interface, and it's literally a lollipop that you draw, okay? And you call this the offered interface. And another component may use or depend on a required interface. And if these two match, then these components are compatible. Like it's like this. They just work together like this, okay? That's just notation the UML uses to indicate this. Sometimes you see it used, and sometimes people abstract from the actual interface and just designate by arrows that there is a dependency. Now, you see this gray matter going on in the background, and this is where you would sometimes use packages. So imagine that I had just drawn packages, okay? So another good use for packages is to structure these components. If you don't want to say where they are deployed, but what their logical role in the architecture is, you can use a package. And when you look at this diagram, it actually gives you some information. It says that there are external systems. There is a B2B layer. In the B2B layer, I have a component that is my business-to-business layer. This is my API, my programming interface, my service interface that the external systems can use and will use, and this is the only one they will use. And then internally, the B2B layer consists of other components, in particular, the account setup workflow, a materials acquisition workflow, an inverter provisioning workflow. And all of these happen to be executed by a workflow engine. Okay, so they are all tied to the workflow engine, and the workflow engine has its own data store in which it stores the state of the workflow. Of each workflow as it is executed. Yes, Charles.
Each of these component boxes is a, I don't want to say the word class, but it's not a representative of a specific instance. Is that correct? So.
That is correct. But you can also represent these as instances. So these are, correct, yes.
You would.
Well, but you would underline, you know, like in an object diagram, we used to underline or, you know, bolden the name with a colon to identify that we're talking about an instance. Mm-hmm. Yeah, good point. Yes.
So would this be the highest level representation of the model?
Not of the model necessarily, but of once you have identified that you want to package up your behavior in components, in individually deployable entities, that's when you would use the component diagram.
So this is specific to behavior, you all know.
Somewhat, because once you decide that your system has executables, there is behavior involved. Okay, so you package up behavior in components. Okay, now you see at the bottom here, I have drawn a number of component symbols that don't have connections to anything. But they have a peculiar label, and I'll draw it for you, I'll zoom in. It says global. This is what the UML calls a stereotype. And what this means is that they can have connection to everything. And anything can have a dependency on them. You do this to show, to declutter the diagram. So for instance, there might be a messaging API that you have. If I was to draw all the dependencies between all the components and the messaging API, the entire diagram would be full with lines. You could see nothing anymore. Okay? And so by labeling this as global, you can identify that anything can have a dependency to this, but I'm not drawing them out explicitly. Similarly to the authenticator API or a logging API, okay? So that's component diagrams. Any questions on component diagrams? Yes, Sarah. Yes. Correct. Not in any, but everything can have a dependency to those components. Okay. So instead of saying, this has a dependency, this has a dependency, this, okay? That's not looking pretty, is it? Okay, that's why I'm labeling this global, and thus I'm decluttering the diagram. Does this make sense, Sarah? Yes? No, we're saying that any one of the other components can have a dependency on the authenticator API. Oh. That's what we're saying.
Not that it does necessarily.
Correct, but it could, yes. Yeah. But if I were to draw the potential, the entire diagram would be full of lines and not, no information is going to be transported that way.
Mm-hmm. Just in a position where you have that layer, it just happens that, that it belongs in that layer, infrastructure layer, so you have an authentication mechanism that can be called throughout the
industry. Yes. Because I labeled it global. Okay? That's what I did here. See, this is the same thing. Yes?
Even though I said global.
Yes, you can.
So as to highlight that.
Yes, you can.
Even though everything could, this one really does.
Yes, you can. Yeah. Okay. Yep. Very good point. How do you enter this in Enterprise Architect? So when you pull a package, what you do is you actually can select a stereotype. So when you want to enter this in Enterprise Architect, you you define a new stereotype in the properties dialog. In Enterprise Architect. Let's see. I don't waste time doing it now. But that's where you would go. So you would right click on the package, on the component symbol, go to the properties dialog, and there's a stereotypes element, and you create a new stereotype and you select it, and you write global there, and that's how you do it. So I won't waste our precious time before lunch. Any questions about component diagrams? Okay. They are often used in the deployment view. They're also used just to give the layout of the land of your application before you deploy. Okay? Because the components are artifacts in and by themselves. And then you can, in our next step, this is what I'm going to show you next. You can map those onto execution engines of some sort. Okay? So glad you asked the question, because that is literally the next diagram. Okay, so we've now taken the journey from sort of purely logical entities, like classes, activity diagrams, sequence diagrams, even package diagrams, to executable entities like components that have code associated with them often, to machines and networks that can actually execute those components. And so the UML has one diagram type called deployment diagram, by means of which we can describe physical or virtual machines, devices, resources in general, on which we can deploy components. And deploy means install them there, like a piece of software that you install on your laptop, right? Then the laptop would be the device, the piece of software would be the deployable component, and you would physically install it on the laptop and make it executable there. And so these bigger boxes here, these are known as nodes. So singular, of course, is the node. And nodes are where things happen, okay? So a node would be something that has, you know, a processing unit, a storage capability, what have you. And it, in this case, it also has network connections. And so one way to describe deployments is to create these nodes. You can have subnodes as well, if your, you know, execution environments are hierarchically structured. So if you think back to our session in November when we talked about cloud, public and private cloud architectures, we also talked about containers. And so you can have one virtual machine as a node that can execute something. And on that virtual machine, I can have multiple containers. That's one way to hierarchically structure nodes. Well, it depends how you want to model it. You can model the container as another node on which you can deploy something, or you can model the container as an artifact that is being deployed on the virtual machine. So the perspective defines which of the two you would pick. if it's important to you that you want to describe that you are ultimately deploying something in the container, then you would treat it as a node. If it's important to you that you deploy the container, then you would treat it as an artifact. Make sense? Okay, so what are we seeing here? We are seeing that our organization has chosen to have a load balancer node. The stereotype used there is device, so the idea apparently is that this is a physical load balancer. And there is an API cluster node, one that actually describes a multiplicity of API processor nodes, or API servers in this case. And it also shows a connection. So this is a connection. Nobody can read this. I made a valiant effort, but was. So this would be a connection, and there is a protocol associated with it. And I'll zoom into this. So this says HTTP. Okay, this is the protocol associated with the connection. What we're seeing here is there is a network connection between these two nodes, and the protocol we want to execute on this network connection is HTTP. Could be UDP, could be TCP, could be whatever you want. Could be email. You could write email, for instance. Okay. Now inside of the API cluster node, I have three other nodes, and these reflect the actual servers that I want to run. And so my API cluster has three nodes in it. One is API server one, the other is API server two, API server three. Each of them has artifacts deployed on them. So this is called an artifact. One type of artifact we encountered in the previous diagram was a component. Okay, so for instance, in this case, it's an api.jar file that has the Java executable that we want to run on this server is an artifact that we want to deploy on the node. You can then have so-called deployment specs. For instance, if you use something like Ansible or Chef or Puppet to describe how a node is configured, that would be considered a deployment spec. Would say how the artifacts make it onto the node, okay? And that's roughly it. I mean, you see the other ones are just different types of protocols, different types of artifacts. For instance, here I have an RPM file that describes, you know, a Postgres executable package. Different types of deployment artifacts that I can have. Okay? But this allows us now to actually go all the way from logical specifications to how the executable environment, the deployment environment for our system looks. Okay? If you think in terms of DoDEV, for instance, we've made when we took the step from or component diagrams and deployment diagrams, we went from the operational views into the systems views. Okay? You're all experts in DoDEV, I presume. Okay? Therefore, this is an easy transition for you. Okay? Okay, any questions about deployment diagrams? Jonathan.
Every single box in there is an instance, a thing that actually does exist?
Yes. Yes. It is a reified thing. Yes.
So a lot of the diagrams that we were seeing, including, well, say, we see classes, the same particular class can show up in several different diagrams, as in kinds of diagrams. It would be in a class diagram. I'm trying to remember the ones we saw. Did we see it in activity diagrams, classes?
Yes, we did.
For like parameter types.
Correct.
Okay, so what I'm wondering is the composite, the things that make up either these. Okay, so here we see in this deployment diagram references to the one we saw for components.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Is there any mapping from components up to either classes or?
Yes. So you can describe that a component actually has the classes in them that make up that executable.
And that would be on a class diagram, probably, right?
In a component diagram, you would show in the box, literally in the box, you would draw in the class. Yeah. Yep. Good question. So the question Chauzer asked was, where do we describe the relationship between a class diagram and the component diagram? And you would actually use the component in a diagram. And so you would use the component diagram or a component diagram to show that a class maps to a particular component that would make the class part of that executable. Yes, well, once you get this thing started, but you know the objects are instantiated from classes, right? So you don't draw objects into the components because when the component executes, it creates the objects.
Is there any way to make things lookable in here so you can like double click on a component and then dictate the class?
Yes. Well, in EA you can always do that because you literally link these things by either making them hierarchically decomposed, or if you drag them onto the entity in a diagram, then you see them right there and you can double click on it. Yes. Yep. Yep. Okay. Any questions about this? I'll skip over the requirements because we did this on day one. I showed you how to create requirements and do those. I will share with you, once you get going on your team exercise, a file that I have created that has a bunch of requirements in it. And there is a CSV importer in Enterprise Architect. I pointed this out on the first day. And all you have to do is to say, I want these fields from the file, and you can import the entire file into a package. Okay. Maybe if we have time at the beginning of the patterns course, I can show it to you then as well. But I want to make sure that you have time after lunch for your exercise. I'm debating with myself, and so let me ask you. So the exercise typically takes about an hour to an hour and a half, okay, depending on how quick you are. But I want to make sure that you have enough time for the team project work. Okay, because I want to be around for your questions while you work on your team project. Would you like to work 1 hour on the exercise or 1.5 hours?
1.5.
Okay, so you do 1.5, that's fine with me. And then after lunch, you start with the exercise. No, it's basically me saying whatever happens, okay? But how about this? I leave it up to you, okay? So every team should decide. Let me make it even more interesting, okay? You start with 1 hour, okay? Everybody works for 1 hour on this. And then you check in your team how far everybody's gotten, okay? If you find that people are struggling, first of all, they should be talking with me because I can help. If you find that people are struggling, you help yourself amongst the team to remove the struggle. And then you go into your team exercise. How about that? Does it sound fair?
Very
subtle. Okay, so let's go to lunch. Come back at 12:30, please. Start immediately with the exercise. I will enable it in Canvas. And then we switch over into the team project. Thank you. Yes. By sending it around. Yes. There are ways to share projects in Enterprise Architect, but they are either very heavyweight, where you have to set up a shared database by your IT department, and then you can start sharing. But it's that's one way. The other way is you can set it up in the cloud or using version control. But this is very brittle. Version control set up with SVN is very brittle, so I don't recommend it. Get your IT department, if you want to do this sort of for the team, get your IT department to provide a shared server. That is one way that has worked in the past. Everything else is very brittle. When you set it up with a shared database, you can. Yes. Hello.
How are you doing?
Good. How are you?
Doing well.
I think we're done in terms of the presentation.
Okay.
Just thinking if there's anything else in the afternoon where we would need this, but I don't think so.
Okay.
Let's see. Here we go. Maybe we can leave it up
just in case. Yeah.
But for now, I think we're good.
All right. Great.
Thank you. Send me an email and just write at the head of the speech because I get so much email and it's very easy for me to miss
topic
or email. So if you put a question or something like this, then it's easier for me to spot. Thank you.
Is this the same presentation discussion I think the diagram you did last year?
No.
I didn't think so. I'm glad to hear that because with more detail I did. My mind is thrashing around saying, holy glory, what the hell? I thought activity diagrams were easier.
No, they're very far.
So this is new.
It is new.
Good. I think it's not
okay. I pitched the entire peak and then stuff in the past because I think it's interesting material, but it didn't allow me to go into as much detail and kind of how it would work. So I noticed this and the cap everything in the
sorry. In the past, Levis is also talking.
Okay.
I don't know if he's going to change it. But anyway, that's very good. I'm glad to hear that you changed from last year because I didn't remember a lot of this stuff. So I'm not totally dead.
No.
That was good.
Yes.
Are the students going to be working just on team and exercise and team stuff? No more lectures from you?
That is correct. I think I have all the lectures.
Okay.
Most of us need to say you're lectured out.
Stragglers. Sounds like Tim wants us to give him a date, right? Okay, what works for you this week? So what do you think about Tuesday morning? Because I'm sure we're not going to be there for more than 2 hours. So that should probably allow me to get back by the time the frontline training starts. Wait, do you think? Now that I look at it, it's at 12. It starts at 12:30. I thought it was 2. Dang it. I thought it was 2 and 12. If we get there at 9 to 11, no, I might not be. What about Monday? Okay, let's shoot on Monday 9:30. Okay, I'll reply to 10. So it sounds like, I don't know, I guess our... So this is our new episode? Okay, good. At least they have someone, which was our episode's concern. And we're not just giving it to a regular Joe or my husband. I think he doesn't necessarily have to, as long as he's like a security personnel versus a PM who you're going to give your PI answers to. Okay. So we're going to get this memo from Jamie. Kind of weird because we have two other security officers that are not cool with it, and then not this guy, he's like, cool with it. So, oh, okay, sorry. I thought you were okay. Okay, that's so annoying because our people are trying to reach David like a ton of times. She said she called him and called him and called him on Monday and nothing. So like this could have been mitigated like last Monday or this Monday. Okay, sounds good. We'll say Monday 9. Okay, thanks, bye. master students is right before us. We can go to the food court and see what they have. And I can it. Mm-hmm.
你剛才不用上班嗎？剛才他痛的時候，哦，你都好彩。 全部搞掂啊！到時如果我話你，如果要嘅話，你到時俾翻我，即係你唔想買一齊買嘅話。但係一開頭嘅話，我可以全部搞掂，睇你信唔信要嘅嘛。我你而家攞20萬，我一定係冇用嘅。我自己唔係冇錢。我咁多年我都付咗利息啦，你都係擺銀行㗎。 咁你若得而我一咁多年，我買咗60幾年啦，我而家都俾緊30幾利息㗎，我嬲我都俾緊10幾利息利息㗎，而家多15蚊同40蚊有冇問題㗎？係咯，一早我都話你一早老豆嗰度俾咗我，咪唔使咯，咪慳到利息咯。 一個禮拜，佢一個禮拜先答應啫嘛，未係買㗎。你仲要經過 escrow， 你 escrow 完咗，跟住你先係俾錢㗎嘛。係一個禮拜之內，一個月咯，一個禮拜之內係你做你 inspection 啫嘛。 係啊，美國都係㗎。唔係㗎，你覺得係咁樣咩 ？Are you sure？ 梗係唔係啦？你而家好似你而家，我覺得肯定唔係。你而家如果早啲俾佢錢啦，見到你半年就係30年嘅，見到29年咯，28年咯。 即係好似你今日，唔係，應該就唔係啦。好似你今日借10蚊，跟住你係10日之後要還曬啦，係咪？咁你譬如你，即係佢當你個年期係10日，咁你今第一日你要還1蚊多少，即係。 意思係話我你要每多一日要還過1咁樣，咁樣計落去啦。總之嗰個數目好難計。咁你如果今日還過2，咁即係你可以擺落嚟 apply on the principle。咁你咪唔使等10日嘅咯喎，變咗9日。你每個月每一日嘅定期，你都要同佢講話，我每一日都會俾你1個1。就意思話你今日俾佢2蚊，唔係等於哦聽日嘅你。 利息會少咗，係聽日個利息係會少咗，但係唔係等於你會俾少過1。 但你都係仍然被播嘅，你明白我講乜嘢？即係咁樣假設，假設你每一個月，你同嗰個政府講，同嗰個銀行講，我每一個月我都要還$100，還夠30年，嗰個咩啦？係咪？跟住你咧，我有大佬林鄭強出嚟講，我同阿發你爭$1,000，我俾你$50啦，我俾你$500啦，跟住你又攞$500擺落去，係咪？咁我唔係還，咁我每個月還$100，跟住我第二日，跟住無啦啦有$500出嚟，咁我擺落去，咁銀行都會叫你下個月都係要俾$100，但係個年期係唔係縮咗係10年嘅喎？點解縮咗係5年嘅咯？可能4年啊、3年就咁樣落去。即係你今年你突然之間俾個一嚿錢落去，唔係等於你下一個 payment 會少咗，你下一個 payment 會 the same as the first the previous month， 但係個 term 係細咗咯。你明白我乜嘢？係啊，唔係你覺得哦，你一早哦，你同阿政府，你同阿銀行講哦，我每個月要還$1,000嘅啫。跟住你今年你第一個月還嘅$1,000全部俾曬利息，$1 principal 都冇。唔係咁，你肯定你咁樣計，你肯定咁樣計。跟住你第咁，你幾時開始還 principal？ 係可以咁樣計，你可以同佢講話 interest only， 你唔還 principal， that's another。第二個 mortgage is not the same。好似你而家同政澳門政府借咗錢啊，你每個月還你白解釋你每個月還$2,000啊。第二點解我俾你$20,000？咁你下個月都係還$2,000，不過你嘅 term 唔係30年，係點樣可能20年？有啲 loan 係有 fix， 即係有 penalty for prepayment， 有啲 loan 係有嘅，我啲冇。咩研究咩？我已經問口唔使啦，我已經咁。我確定咗，我都係咁樣嘅。你應該確定啊，台灣係真係係哦，我第一年成年都係還利息嘅。如果係我，咁即係每一個，咁你頭先有同我講話哦，如果你還多啲啦，但係你還多啲咧，全部擺喺 interest 嗰度。哎呀，你都唔買啊！I don't think they understand me though.
Just play it back to a translator. I'll email you the transcript later.
So it's Tonger and Miranda Scripters are functional programming languages, and Miranda is the proprietary one. This one's can't have a proprietary language.
Well, on the other side, it's a separate
programming language. I'm not sure.
Pascal.
Yeah.
But right.
You
can
use
2 years and press that else and we'll do something else.
We'll not do that. So this is the program is represented as a value of type.
We need to get more because I'm not at all convinced that they need the same history. The word stream is
very shifty.
Pretty shifty.
Oh, gosh.
Which is a reason that we see that they have macros. He's not doing it for functional purity reasons like that.
Right.
He can do anything in purity he wants that to at any point, and he doesn't want to.
Well, he doesn't.
Well, he wants to package up as we can think of.
He's never said it's a
car. Right.
Great, thank you. Okay, so welcome back after lunch. The exercise file should now be available to you on Canvas. It's basically, the idea is you model escrow using activity diagrams, the escrow process. Has everybody heard of the escrow process? Wow. Well, Trevor does. Yes, okay, that's good. So if you buy a house, there is a process that happens that is called escrow. And what happens there is that this is about mutual trust, okay, or distrust, depending on whether you have a positive outlook on life or a slightly more challenging one. What it says is there's a transaction going on between the buyer and the seller, and typically there's an additional set of parties involved. For instance, banks who fund loans. Sometimes it's realtors who help in the process, et cetera, et cetera. The title agency, et cetera. They all have certain steps to perform in the process, and only when particular actions have occurred or activities have concluded, the next set of activities can proceed. And in particular, the title can change hands only once the funding has been secured. Okay? So this is one example of an escrow process. I have a link to a Wikipedia page in the file, I think, for other escrow processes. Another type of escrow process, by the way, is where, let's say you work with a vendor who doesn't look all that viable, but they provide certain assets, and you say, well, I want you to put these assets into escrow. And so when you can't deliver the service that I'm asking you to deliver, I will take receipt of all those assets. Okay. For instance, software is an asset. Let's say you have source code, the vendor has supplied to you a system, and they are delivering it as a system to you, but the source code for the system goes into escrow. And if the vendor goes belly up, you get the source code so that you can continue to survive as a business, even if the vendor has disappeared. Different kind of escrow process. What the exercise says is use activity diagrams to model an escrow process. And you can pick any one of them and just play with the idea of modeling such a process. What you'll need are lifelines for the different parties who are involved. And then you need to draw activities and connect them just like we did earlier in class. Make sense? Okay. So my suggestion is you work on this for an hour, let's say until 1:30, take stock how far you come. And as a team, you can decide to help each other out. So if one of your team members, for instance, needs help, help them, but then transition into your team project. Yes. You mean the examples? I can do it now, okay. And if you could share at the end of the day when you're done working with your teamwork project, either now or later in the weekend, send me a copy of your EAP file so that I see how what your progress is on the project. That would be lovely. Make sense? I'll be here until 5 p.m. So make good use of my presence. If you have any questions, either for the activity diagram exercise or for your team project, just holler and I'll be there. Sounds good? Everybody knows what to do? Click away.